Go! Go!
Concussions are a big deal. And for a long time, we've thought that they play a really big role in contributing to something called chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE. CTE is a serious neurodegenerative disease that we see in people like pro sports players and military veterans. It involves the death of your brain cells, causes cognitive dysfunction and dementia, and even early death. It can be really hard to diagnose, prevent, and treat. But research from LLNL and collaborators like Boston University has now given us a better understanding of what causes CTE. And it's not concussions. Plus, this research now brings us one step closer to uncovering what a concussion actually is. For many years, it was thought that accumulated damage from repeated concussions was the main contributing factor to whether someone developed CTE. But the data showed something kind of confusing. 15 to 20% of athletes who developed CTE had never been diagnosed with a concussion. And if concussions are supposed to cause CTE, then those are some odd stats.
What we noticed is that there was just no correlation with documented, witnessed, or reported concussions. Really none whatsoever. About 15 to 20% of the neuropathologically diagnosed cases of CTE had no history of concussion. And it was also true in some of our younger cases in the teenage years and 20s. We're seeing a neurodegenerative disease in teenagers and 20-year-olds, which is astounding.
Clues like this made Lee and others in this field start to look a little more closely at what is actually happening to the brain when you experience traumatic brain injury, or TBI. What you need to know about head injuries is that they can be caused by two basic mechanisms: impact and blast. Blast injuries are traumatic brain injuries that result from a high-pressure wave of air encountering the head, basically rattling your brain around. We see this kind of injury in military service members who have been near explosions. On the other hand, impact injuries are the result of a direct impact with some other solid thing, like another person's head.
And TBI is an event. It's like a heart attack is an event. So TBI is an event, an insult to the brain. It was believed for many, many years that the blast wave, which is essentially a moving wall of air, think of a tsunami of air coming at you, would do something to the head when it hit and passed over the head. And there was something about that sudden change in pressure, because it's a high pressure wave, that would cause the traumatic brain injury, or cause the CTE. So it was believed that that would do something magical.
Lee and his team in Boston began to investigate the differences between impact and blast injuries. The experiments they designed produced identical motions of the head in experimental models, just with different starting mechanisms. And the experiments showed that both blast and impact sources caused TBI and early stage CTE, but only impact caused concussions.
This was completely confusing to us. So this was at odds with everything in the literature and with our understanding. And the conversation I had with Willie, I remember it very well, was how can this be? How can we reconcile those two observations? It must be in the realm of physics and biomechanics. It can't be magic.
So Lee called and said, what is going on? We have this crazy experimental result. We don't understand it. It's unanticipated, totally unexpected.
So then Willie and his colleagues at Livermore took the physics of the problem, the properties of brain tissue, the speed and force and pressure of the blast wave or the impact, and they put it to work in simulations running on some of the fastest supercomputers in the world, which live here at the lab.
Yeah, so supercomputers and the codes that run on them can be very useful in trying to explain experiments. We've seen that in a wide variety of subjects that we have studied. There's a certain amount of analyst judgment as far as what's important in the physics and what's not. And once you have figured out the right material models, the right loadings and all that, then you can look in details at a scale that you can't see in the experiment as far as, okay, what exactly is going on? Where are the concentrations of stresses? Where are possible sites where damage can occur, and then you can get really into detail where you would not be able to see that in the experiment.
The simulations allowed us to see in detail how the stress was affecting the brain and how those forces caused the different kinds of injuries they do. And the details are kind of stunning.
Essentially, what we did was we looked at two things. We looked at pressure and shear. If you think about the ways you can deform a material, you can basically squeeze it, change its volume, pressure, or you can twist it. Any type of deformation you can perform on a material is a combination of those two. The pressures looked more or less the same in both cases. What we noticed was the distribution of shear stress was vastly different in the two cases.
In subjects that experienced blast, there was almost no shear stress. The hypothesis here is that the pressure wave exerts a more uniform force around the head. Like, okay, if this is your head, then this is a pressure wave. Whereas with impact, you have one focused contact point for that same amount of force. So the shear stress that your brain experiences from that unequal distribution of force is what disrupts small blood vessels, nerve fibers, and chemical channels in the brain, producing the symptoms of concussion.
So your initial question was, what is concussion? Well, we still don't know the answer to that. And we don't understand what the biology is that ties the energy to the acute problems that we see. The reason we have a wishy-washy definition of concussion that requires a consensus every couple of years to reshape it is we don't understand it. So again, using the tools that we've developed together, we're in the perfect position to understand what concussion is, and we're very actively working on that now.
Concussion and CTE are totally unrelated. You don't have to be concussed to get CTE, and vice versa. They're completely separate. So that's important because it suggests various strategies one could use to mitigate. You can deal with concussions separately from CTE. You want to avoid accelerations to avoid the chronic traumatic encephalopathy. You want to distribute the load to try and minimize concussion. Those can be addressed separately. And it means that there are some strategies that one can use. So a little bit of the mystery has been removed.
And this is already leading to prevention, diagnostics, and even therapeutics. We're working up new therapeutics for this disease now, and preventive measures as well, and new diagnostics based on these findings.
There are many unanswered questions from what we've uncovered as far as the concussion or not, concentration of shear stress. There are some things that Willie is working on now with Boston to come up with more detailed models. The various folds that are in the brain, what effect could that have on concentrations of damage in the brain? The other area of things to be done is more protection. With the idea that a concentrated load causes concussion, then if the threat is an impact load, you can try to design helmets to do a better job of spreading out that load within the helmet rather than relying on the skull to do it, which if you're getting a concussion, it probably is what's going on.
It's sort of like there's this giant maze and maybe we've cracked the door open and now we can see inside the maze. I think what we did will help with helmet design. That's only going to affect a piece of the problem. It also separates out where to look if you're interested in treating, say, CTE versus concussion, because they're now separated out. We sort of know how much we don't know. We know where to begin looking. And we have a better idea of how to look with some of these results. There's just a little bit of information that we finally have in hand, so there's a little bit of understanding. And the way any hard problem is solved, whatever the field is you have this tough problem to analyze and you find a tiny crack in it, and you chip away at it and you start to crack the problem open. And it's just the way very hard problems are solved. Say we're at the beginning, we're really at the beginning. We finally reached the beginning of the problem, I think. That's another way of looking at it.
And speaking of the beginning, Livermore just this past month announced a collaboration to advance AI research that will work on a huge range of subjects, including improving the diagnosis and treatment of neurological diseases like CTE. This could be the start of a whole new era of understanding our brains and how to keep them safe. If you want to stay up to date with our exciting innovations in supercomputing, make sure you subscribe to this channel for more videos like this, and follow us on our social platforms to see the science news that we post every day. If you have questions about this research, let us know down in the comments below, and as always, thanks for watching.